Welcome back. We find ourselves in what might be the endgame area. We'll see. At the very least, I see a nice place to set ourselves down. So, let's get ready for some tough stuff. I've been waiting for the shoe to drop on the really tough puzzles. So, we might get there one of these days. We'll see. Alright. A classic setup. Just like the introduction to the Infinity Exit Zone. We've gotta set that up ahead of time. We have to be able to recognize that we can create a paradox out of a paradox. We push... If this has nowhere to go, then we push it out of its own parent. And so its parent has to be the double infinity box. But of course, if we've made it this far into the game, we can recognize an analogy when we see one. So there we go. There's... Exiting out of the same room infinitely often would dump us out of here. But if that dumps us out of the same room again, it'll dump us out here, actually. Alright, that much we understand so far. But what do we do about this? Well, if I do this right, I might be able to extract all of this out of the wall. But here's the interesting, like, tactical conundrum, is how are we going to maintain this for long enough to get them both off the wall? Because, sure, I could do this, for example. That works well enough, but... To get this off of this wall, I guess we'll do it this way. Now we don't need the double infinity box, now we just need the single infinity box. That'll get that out. Now we have both of them, we don't need the double infinity box, just needed these two. Sure. And of course it's only a matter of time, like, you know, why stop at two infinities? We could have a three infinity box, a four infinity box. It's really just, you know, how many, how many infinities does the puzzle author care about? We could even have, I think, well, I guess it'd depend on how things are set up, how things are modeled. Would it be possible to have a box that had an infinite number of infinities in here? I'm not sure. That might imply, like, you might need, like, an infinite number of these. That might not actually work. You'd need, like, an infinitely large box to have a countably infinite number of infinity boxes all on one edge. Plus one for you to exit on. Then there would be an infinite infinity box. But there might be another way to do it that I'm not thinking about at the moment. That's entirely possible. So, we'll simply extract the normal box, the infinity box, and the double infinity box the same way we've been doing all up to this point. These are still the exact same tactics, so I'm gonna do them the same way. Now we can get both of them on this wall, that's how we get that one out, and that's all we really need, right? There we go, so... We would be pushing this outside of itself, so that's how we get that out. We would be pushing this outside of the normal box, so that's how we get that out. And we have all of them now. Okay, this is still the easy stuff. Even this is still the easy stuff. We have plenty of room up here. So... This is good. I just gotta think a little bit about how to do this. Let's start... Okay, I think we're going to be popping up a whole bunch of stack stuff here, so I think we'll start with this. There we go. So now if I pop double infinity out of the room, it should come out of triple infinity. But now it's already in place, so now all I have to do is pop infinity out. And now that's already in place, so all I have to do is pop regular room out. Now regular room is in place, so I just pop myself out. Makes sense. We'll leave those for last, sure. That'll help me disambiguate between these two things. We'll take the main path. Alright, stands to reason. If you can have, multiple infinities, you can have multiple epsilons. A series of exception catchers, but that one that eventually bottoms out. So at the very end, we want to enter triple epsilon from the top. That means in double epsilon, we want to set up an epsilon that we enter from the top, which means that we'll want something up here. That's all right. And each of these seem to be their own independent rooms, so I think that's also okay. For you, though, we'll have to get that off the bottom, or will we? Maybe we won't. I think we can cross that bridge when we get to it, because all of these actually exist inside this room, so we've got, like, entrance traps here, but, you know, we can always exit out any of these epsilons back into the main room, and that's okay, so I think we can just experiment, and we don't have to see everything ahead of time. That's what I'm getting at. So there's our single epsilon. We'll turn that into a double epsilon. Now it's a double epsilon. Now for a triple epsilon, we'll want to get both of these out, but that's fine, because like I just demonstrated, we can just kick these out, so we'll just feed some stuff into the double epsilon from the top. There it goes. And now we've got our triple epsilon stack, and it's all nice and visible all within the same universe, all nice and tidy. There we go. Okay, similar idea, but the rooms are more different from one another. In fact, I've got a, there's an epsilon continuation, I guess we'll call it, right there and right here. And at the very end, I'd just like to enter here, push that to the right, and exit. Alright. But I have to finish here. And have something here. So there might be some amount of, yeah, I can enter these from the top, but I can adjust conditions in them as needed. Interesting. Okay, so before we do anything, before we start going down the stacks, let me put this here. I'm gonna need that later. Yeah, later on I'll want to enter here, disable the continuation, kind of pry that away. Then this will be a teleporter. Then I'm free to block this off. That's how that's gonna work, I think. Alright, so now, let's go to double epsilon. There we go, now we've set up our triple epsilon, and we can get the box out. Just keep that there, we'll use that later. We have access to triple epsilon, so let's go there. Alright, that's tripped. Now we can get back in here later, from the south entrance. And we're good. Gonna have to work harder than that to mess me up. Okay. Intriguing. This one's entirely clogged up, but we've got the right wall here, so. And a limited number of these. And I can... So if this ever bottoms out... I wonder if I need all these. I mean, I probably do with the way this is set up. Almost certainly probably do, but I'm just trying to think about what will happen. Alright, so none of these are able to eat each other with the way this is all set up. So this is all, with the right wall there, this is a device to make sure that I eat everything from the right end, I think. No, I'm wrong. Of course I am. Right, the left wall is open. Right, and of course things keep teleporting here, so we get a cycle. Of course. Okay, let me take my time here. This is technical. This is very technical. So, this is normal. This pushes the whole stack, and then there's room to eat something in here. So that just results in another clone being put here, which is fine. Now we've got a single epsilon going on here. At the very end, it would be useful if the green block appeared here. Then I could just simply put it aside and go down here and push it up and enter it. So I think I do want this whole thing to get filled with a series of epsilons. So let's eat a block. Now eat one of those. There, that's there now. Let's eat some more yummy, tasty yellow blocks. Put one there. Put another one here. And eat some more yummy, yummy yellow blocks. And put one there. Now we've got a series of cascading epsilons, and the green block should appear here. And that's perfect. Okay. Makes sense. It's tricky, but it makes sense. Now the final exam. And at the end of the day, it would be lovely if I could go here. I'll end up here. I can go in here. And we'll just set up a whole bunch of epsilons. And then if I get sufficient epsilonage, I'll appear in here and I can go there. All right. It looks complicated, but I think it's just actually really simple, right? We'll just use a whole bunch of infinities. I don't even really have to count them. The game will let me know. Okay, actually we're here. Okay, so the final puzzle was actually not that hard at all. It was visually impressive, which honestly, in a relatively easy but visually impressive final puzzle is actually probably better than a super hard, like, you know, bone-breaking, difficult super puzzle. You can put that bone-breakingly difficult super puzzle in the post-game, and people will still get to play it and be happy. But this is a nice way of summing everything up. That's it. That's as deep as we had to go. That is the very bottom. And the units at the very bottom were no less small or diminished for their tiny size, for there was plenty of room down there. Plenty to learn. Well, that's it. We solved Patrick's Parabox. That's where the goal was, all the way at the bottom. And that's it. We solved the main campaign. There's a couple of puzzles left. Sure, I'll get to them. But this is a lovely game. Oh, hey, there's Hempuli right there. And I'm sure all these people I haven't heard of, I think I might have seen you. I think you're from, like, the NecroDancer community, if I remember right. Anyway, all these people are probably amazing in their own ways, even if I've never heard of them before. you know, you don't have to have a published product to be an amazing person. You can just be an amazing person. So yeah, this is a great puzzle game, and I'm glad that a lot of people got involved with it and really helped polish it all to a sheen. I'm gonna have to check that out at some point. So a neat take on recursion. I think there's plenty of room for different themes along recursion. Oh yeah, and there's recursed right there. Yep. So this is, I'm sure this is not the last word that's been written on this. We could have an entirely different recursive video game that was very different. Maybe it wouldn't involve Sokoban. Maybe it'd be like a 3D platformer. Maybe it'd be a recursive RPG. Who knows? Anything is possible. Just gotta be able to set it up right and make it snappy enough and fun enough, however that mystery term works, for people to want to play it. Of course there's a post-game world. Of course there is. But before we go there, let's take a few more samplers here and make sure we're in good shape for it. I'm a little bit disappointed we didn't get to go to level red and fight the cone, but it's okay. We can be the defender of the polyverse some other time. Alright, so now we've got a problem. We just ended out the game, the whole game itself, having plenty of room to just line up a whole bunch of exits, but this time it's not going to be that simple. I think I get it, though. What if instead of having one tile at the exit, what if we had more space? I think that might be just what the doctor ordered. Just have more room. And, sure. I'm not sure this will actually accomplish what I want, but let's at least see what happens. Like, sure, that whole space is empty, but I think all that I'm doing now, which is a problem, is that I'm just gonna push green out the bottom here. So now, well, actually, that's fine. Right, I left that there. I left the actual copy of the room there. It's beyond the boundary, the border, so now it's where I want it to be. So now if I pop myself out, now it's just fine. Now we come out of blue, which involves coming out of green, and we're good. So that's all there was to it. I was a little concerned there would be something special I'd have to do to make sure that I myself could make that transition, but it's fine. There was enough room there that I could put green there, and it was alright. Okay, similar idea, looks familiar, but... in fact, this ought to make things easier because now it's more clear what order I have to do things in. I just have to be careful about how I do it. So, I think I get it, actually. Double infinity needs to come out the top of itself. So double infinity goes there, but single infinity needs to go out the right. So I need to set this up this way. Alright, double infinity. Single infinity, right? No, this box needs to be on the right side now. Right, of course. So we get a cycle of course, we have infinity coming out of the normal room, so it just pops out and pushes itself, of course. So what I need then, actually, is this, right? No, that won't work because I just ate the room with the clone of itself, so it just appears there. That's not enough. What I actually needed was to keep these separated. Okay, let me be a little bit more disciplined about this. Let me push this around in a more Sokoban-like manner. Don't let those things get next to each other because I have to push them independently. Triple infinity can just go straight here. That's fine. Right. Double infinity goes out of itself and out of this, so it ends up here. Now, I think I use the clone to rescue blue. I don't think I'm going to need this for anything else other than that. So that's fine. Now everything goes on the right wall. Good, but we still have this problem. Okay, I see how to solve it. So at the very end, this clone needs to be able to pop out here, which means I needed to use this shelf as the bottom bracing, not that wall. Makes sense. Just wasn't thinking about it, but yeah, makes sense in hindsight. That's fine. This isn't that long of a puzzle. Thankfully, they didn't make us do this 5 times. 3 is enough. 3 is the magic number. Right, I did that wrong. Quadruple infinity's out here. No, no. There are a lot of steps involved, but they're all very, very simple steps. Okay. Put this here. That's a much more useful spot to put it than down here. Alright, that's more like it. That's exactly where I want everything to be. Okay, well I can end the game again if I want to just step on here, but a reward, of course, for doing a whole bunch of puzzles is more puzzles. Oh, well thank you. Thanks everyone for making, like I said. Well, there's all the rooms. I'm clicking on them and nothing's happening, so I think this is just like an observatory. Just like a, hey, here's something I can do with the engine kind of thing. Ooh. Hmm. This is me piloting the self, by the way, but, all right. Just for fun, I guess I'll press 7. Okay, no, there is no alternate display mode for this thing. It's just a toy. Alright, well, I think I've seen just about enough here. Ooh, we can select music. Alright. Well, we have all of this music now. Reception, huh? Alright. Okay, well, I guess I'll do these things in reading order. Looks like I might have a lot of work left here. Yeah, reception. Alright, a whole bunch of challenges. Alright, that'll keep me busy. The gallery. An interesting appendix if we really want to drill down into the engine rules. Alright. A lot of, and wraps around. Okay. This is gonna be a big post-game, and, this is a warp room. Alright, just in case we wanted to just go to any arbitrary unit, here they all are. So we didn't see, mirroring come back. I guess that'll be for challenges, mostly. Maybe some specific challenges in that. Didn't end up really mixing that with the rest. I'm sure there's something to be said for all that. This is obviously going to be pretty time-consuming to do. That's going to be multiple episodes. I feel like I want to take a peek in the gallery first. That seems a little bit clearer. Neat. Well, these things don't always work out the way you think they will. Maybe you set up the engine, and then you think, I'd like to use this engine for something else. Yeah, as the modeling work is one thing. Like, you probably... I wouldn't be surprised if the developer started out with the ASCII version and then thought about how are we going to animate this stuff. But, you know, obviously they had a super solid, like, mechanical underpinning of the whole thing where they had an answer to everything. And a... Like, they, that's the nice thing about how this puzzle game works, is that the states are super obvious. You always know exactly where everything is. It's just a matter of computing what will happen when you go outside of a boundary. And obviously that is pre-computable. So, at that point, then you can decide, what are we going to be drawing outside? And I'm sure there's some plenty of recursion going on with, you know, drawing things and then deciding, like, what's the horizon for, like, drawing? Like, you stop the Drost effect at a certain point. Or you decide that you stop drawing the outside at a certain point. So, that's all the really nitty-gritty programmery stuff that you have to think about. You know, it was a solid enough idea that all this stuff became possible to do because the foundation was so solid. So it's just really neat. Yeah, a visualization of the structure of boxes. That could be pretty useful. Yeah, and that's the amazing thing about this, is that your edge cases become levels. Because they are the mechanics that you want everyone to be aware about. It's cool. It's really cool. Yeah. I can understand that. Yeah, especially, like, flipping probably gives you enough of what you want most of the time without needing rotation. Like the fact that you can have arbitrarily sized boxes and thus an arbitrarily large number of cells on the edge of a box probably gives you enough, like, depth without needing another dimension of depth, so to say. Ah. Yep, that'll happen. But that's why we take notes. They're good to have. And then, yeah, might as well, in the editor, things don't have to look like they do in-game. Sometimes it's just clearer to, have things be nice and clear, and then you just draw them fancily when you get into the game itself. Yep, there they are. So I guess that's every box. Yeah, like, it's not just every room and every, like, level thumbnail in the hub. It's literally every box in the game. Ha. It's possible, though. I mean, all that data is right there. Huh. Alright. So there are puzzles in the gallery? I guess we'll see. There they are. So they would have looked like this. And of course, like, there's an innumerable number of great quality of life things, like highlighting the boxes when you put your cursor over them, and being able to click on boxes to go inside them, and I'm sure it feels painful to a certain extent to have to disable some of that stuff, but you have to, like, you just have to do that. So, I guess this was one of the earliest crafted, like, test levels, I guess. Like, once the engine was solid enough to support that. So I want to enter this on the right, and if I press 7, then we get back to normal mode. Okay, so that probably became another graphics mode, just added to the rotation. Interesting. So how am I going to enter this and have bracing on the left, but still be able to get it back out later when I want it? Because, of course, if I do this, then we have a problem where, how's that going to work? Wherever I put this, I need to be able to repeatedly, like, I need to enter from the top and push that down, and then be able to enter on the right again. So, of course, the next step to consider is putting this inside blue. Where does that get us? We still need some bracing of some kind. Let me try it again from this angle. So at the very least, I know I can do that. Okay, I think I get it. At the, like, after I do those downward pushes, at the very end, I need to be able to... I think I want to be able to use blue to eat green, and then I can get it back. But this is set up wrong to be able to do that with. Yeah, this won't work. So at the very end, I might need to be able to... pop green out the top of blue, maybe. Then I can use blue to eat green. And then green will appear in the center of blue, and then I can push it out to the right. But then how do I work with that? Yeah, this is a tricky one. I mean, good. I'm glad this is tricky, but it's, okay, what if I put blue down here? Yeah, this is a useful place for something like this, because it'll keep getting recentered every time I pop it out and put it back in. And that might be exactly what I need. Okay, I feel like I probably did do a puzzle like this a while ago, and I probably just forgot about it. Yeah, because now we can put it back in and we can get it out. Okay. Something like that had to be possible. Like, I needed to enter it on the right and then on the left, so something, some sort of funny business was going on. Alright, this is just an early implementation of the camera system. Intriguing that it kind of recenters the room like this. Like, it kind of gets painted on the left here, and this is a lot more room on the right than normally there would have been. And yeah, you can actually see the whole... Like, of course you could see the upper boundary here, and the left boundary, and the lower boundary, but it's interesting that it's set up so that the player is in the center, and you get a nice, clean view of two whole tiles here. So if there was another box right here that you were transferring into, you'd be able to see that whole thing as well. And indeed, that might be what I'm actually supposed to do here. And then, of course, if I... that doesn't look so great. And then, of course, if I do this, then it'll end up getting painted like that. So... so now I can pop out of blue. So sure, I can do that. Oh, and then of course now I can pop green out of blue. So now I have green inside green. Right, of course. And then what's that good for? Like, now do I want to put... Yes, I think now I want to put green inside blue, and now I can put blue here, and that seals up everything behind myself, but I'm on the correct side of everything. Ha! Alright. We had some tricky puzzles, and they didn't really cleanly fit into the difficulty curve, or they might have made a unit too long, so we'll just save them and we'll put them here. That's fine. Yeah, we are not done with the game, not by any stretch of the imagination. Now, how am I going to exit down to pry that out? So, of course, I could pop green out of blue, but something more... Is it more productive to do this? I mean, now the left edge of blue is out here, but that doesn't help me because it's on the bottom. Yeah, that doesn't do anything. But how else will I get to the bottom part of blue? Well, maybe I could transfer into blue. Maybe that's the right idea. And that would be cool were it not for the fact that I've got room to push this, so I can't transfer from blue to green out the left edge, but I can enter here. So that's how I could get that out. Now I need to figure out how to get this out. So I need to get green out, I need to be able to put it here and then appear in green somehow. Well, I know how. Popping is a great way to appear inside something without needing to push it. There we go. So now I've got green out. Maybe before I pop out, let me pop blue out. I should have enough room to push that. Yeah, that... Okay, that'll do. And now I have everything. Now I have everything I want. Neat. Concise, small, but it works. Okay. I'm gonna have my hands full finishing up all the rest of this stuff, that's for sure. But neat. I wanted to keep playing the game, and... What do you know? I can keep playing the game.